And this is Lit Happens, your celebration of the literary arts here in Saskatchewan. Today I'm very pleased to welcome Edward Willett. Now, Edward is an award-winning author of more than 60 books. He writes fantasy, science fiction, and nonfiction for all ages. Today, we're going to talk about his new book of poetry, I Tumble Through the Diamond Dust. Edward, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Danica.
It's great to have you on. I haven't had you on the show, and you have so many books, and I've seen you at so many shows and readings and all sorts of events. You're out there. You're always promoting writing in this province and your own work. And so I'm really pleased to have you here.
I'm very happy to be here. I don't know why it's taken so long. I'll come back sooner next time.
Excellent. So today, this book is a little different than a lot of your other books.
This is very different for me. I've never self-identified as a poet. The amount of poetry I've written over the years you could certainly count without having to use your thumbs, I think, even. But this came up because of Gerald Hill, who was the poet laureate 2 years ago, had a challenge for Poetry Month, which was April, and that every weekday he sent out 2 lines of published Saskatchewan poetry to all the members of the Saskatchewan Writers Guild. And the challenge was to create either a work using those lines or responding to them in some way. And much to my surprise, I wrote a poem every day that he did that, 21 in all. And they're all, because of the way my mind works, they're all science fiction, fantasy, or horror, I guess, would be the kind of the 3 categories they would fall under. So I had these 21 poems. I put them online. I got a good response to them. Some of them appeared in On the Line, which was a collection of work coming from that challenge, published by Berna Barclay and her Burton House books in Regina. They were edited quite a bit differently for that than they are in my own book. And then I thought, well, to make it a more interesting, how about some illustrations? So I cast around for artists, and I talked to some different people. Then I finally realized I was an idiot because my niece, Wendy Nordell, who lives in northern Alberta, is a wonderful artist. And so I got her to illustrate the book. So this is very much a family affair. And it's published by Your Nicholsworth in Regina.
Well, and it's really wonderful because when you flip through it, you have these really rich, lovely black and white line drawings.
And I like the way that we set it up, or that Heather Nichols set it up. We have the 2 lines because we want to give credit to all of these, because some of their work, their lines actually appear in the poems. There's also a complete bibliography at the back that lists all of the books that the poetry came from. So if you're interested, you can go and find those. So we have the 2 lines, and then you see her artwork, and then you turn the page, and then you see the poem. So it's interesting that you'll see her, and I said, I want to see exactly what it inspires in you. I didn't give her much direction. I don't think I gave her any direction on any of them. I just said, draw what the poem suggests to you. So you see her interpretation, and then you see the actual poem. I think it's a very interesting way to encounter the poems.
And a way to not only present these poems, but to entice people to look at other poetry that comes from this province as well.
I hope so, because that bibliography at the back is a really rich list of great poetry books. So I hope people will, I hope they enjoy my poems, but I hope they will also follow up on some of the poets whose work Jerry sent out over that month.
Would you like to read to
I would.
Us a little bit?
This is a poem called There's Nothing Artificial About Love, and it's kind of timely because there's a lot of talk about artificial intelligence and robots and things. So, oh, and the 2 lines that this incorporates are, You Got Talking Just Because, which is by Randy Lundy from a poem called Just Because in Under the Night Sun, and What Other Friend or Lover After All Would Have Been So Faithful More or Less by Elizabeth Brewster, a poem called To the Male Muse in her 2nd volume of collected poems. This is what I did with those. For 3 full weeks, you sat and you said nothing, a silent presence in my living room. The manual said that it would take a while, heuristic that, and quantum this, at work. And then it happened. One day you got talking, just because I think the silence stretched too long. You said, I am L5, you are named Jack, and I am sure that we will be great friends. Don't think that I don't know that you're a robot. Of course I know, I haven't gone insane. I know beneath your skin of soft pink plastic, your skeleton's titanium and steel. But more and more I'm spending nights at home. I look at you and you look back at me. And while I understand that you can't love me, I don't see why that means I can't love you. The truth is that I do. I've never had a real live girl who cared a bit for me. And even though I know that you were programmed to treat me like the center of your world, I don't see any reason to look further, to risk humiliation from the real. I know your mind is shared with many others connected to a server in Ukraine, and all of you pretend to love your owner, and all of you are equally unreal. And there are other men in other cities who love a part of you as much as I. But I don't care. I'll live with you forever, and when at last they lay me in the ground, they'll lay your metal skeleton beside me and write this epitaph above the grave. It's true he loved an artificial life form, but please don't find that reason to condemn. For what other friend or lover, after all, would have been so faithful, more or less?
Thank you. So it's always interesting to see how people are inspired by the work of others, and where your imagination, 60 books and all these wonderful fantasies that you've written, your imagination goes in really wonderful places. Do you have any advice for other people who are trying to open up that imagination?
Well, it all goes back to what I read, right? Reading as a kid. I had two older brothers who both read science fiction and fantasy, so I grew up with that. And very early on, I latched onto that. The first short story I ever wrote when I was 11 years old was called Castor Glass Hypership Test Pilot. So you can see I locked into that pretty early on. And when you read fantastic fantasy, science fiction, surreal things, it just wakes up your mind a little bit. And it's like a muscle that you exercise. And pretty soon, I took two lines of poetry that had nothing to do with science fiction or fantasy, and I found a fantastical element to build around in each one of those.
And so do you have more poetry percolating in your
brain? Well, the funny thing is I haven't written another poem since 2 years ago because I'm writing other things. I will see if this, you know, if this people like this one, then I could easily, well, not easily, but I could do it again. And I'm sure Wendy would be interested in illustrating it again too. But I'm more focused on book-length fiction and nonfiction most of my time.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's interesting because some of your books are quite long, and these are a whole story just in a few lines.
They are, and I could actually go through this, and most of them I could turn into a short story or a novel. Because of the way my mind works, they probably turn into novels. I don't think I'll do that. But 21 novels might be a bit of an overkill reaction to this.
But it does show that even with all of these books and this 21 micro stories or flash fiction or poetry, little tiny bits that you've pulled together, the tap isn't turning off for you.
No, I've got story ideas for days. I mean, there's no shortage of ideas.
So do you have something that you're really excited about that you're working on right now?
Yes, my next novel is coming out in September from my New York publisher, Daw Books, and it's supposed to launch a series. They bought the first two books, and hopefully there'll be more after that. And it's called World Shaper, and it's quite different for me, too, because it's largely a first-person narrative, which I've never done in an adult novel, and it's first-person female character. And it starts out like it's in our world, but it turns out it's not. And it's because it's first person, it gets all my sense of humor into it as well. So they're calling it fantasy. It actually has a science fiction underpinning. We'll call it fantasy science fiction. And I'm really hopeful that it will prove popular and will take off.
Well, and it's interesting to see how people genre, how they label genres and where they cross. And it's really interesting to see. I've seen a little bit more poetry that's fantasy, science fiction, and that's sort of an interesting thing that's taking off right now.
There's a whole organization called the Science Fiction Poetry Association, sfpa.org, I think. They have a collection every year, and they give awards, the Reisling Awards. That name comes from a science fiction story by Robert A. Heinlein about a poet. So yeah, it actually is. It's not, people don't think of it, but it's there and it's percolating around. And a lot of the science fiction, some of the science fiction magazines will publish poetry as well. So it's actually a poetry market, which is interesting because there aren't a lot of those around.
Well, Edward, that's all the time we have for today. It's been a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to be on.
Thank you. I'm Danica Lohr, and this is Lit Happens. You can find past episodes by going to Shaw TV Saskatoon on YouTube. You can find me on Facebook or Twitter. You can email me at danicalohr@gmail.com. Thanks for watching.